Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Sucheta Dilal. I'm a trustee of Manulife Foundation. We have a lot of new faces here today. This is our second lecture on wellness. Many of you may have attended the last one, which was by Professor Hegde. This one is on chelation therapy. I'm most delighted to welcome Mr. V.V. Gokhale here and Dr. Kundaskar, who works with him in administering the chelation therapy. So I'm going to ask Alek, my colleague who actually works on wellness related issues, to give you a more formal introduction of Mr. Gokhale.
And thank you, ma'am. I'm Alek Angre, working as a reporter with Manulife. Mr. Gokhale, he's a B.Tech and M.Tech from IIT Bombay. In 1991, he was diagnosed to have a heart attack. He was drawn to read on the subject of heart diseases. His reading later shifted to medicine in general. In 2006, he suffered a severe heart attack. Cardiologists advised him to undergo triple vessel bypass surgery and was told that if he doesn't undergo it, there is no chance of him to survive for more than 6 months. In the same period, he learned about chelation therapy. Although he was sure about its usefulness, he double-checked its efficacy and contacted 12 people who have undergone the same. He got mixed reaction and concluded that it's 100% safe and efficacy score was around 87%. Immediately, he underwent 20 chelation drips despite the advice to undergo bypass surgery. His health condition improved and he came out with a healthy heart. Based on his experience, he wrote 2 books in Marathi. His latest books, Angioplasty, Bypass Surgery Myths and Chelation Therapy, published in April 2011, has been widely recommended by specialist doctors and also International Board of Clinical Metal Toxicology. He has also keen interest in computers. In 1992, after returning from Dubai and Greece, he was contacted to give computer training to the staff of Health Department of Government of Maharashtra. In the same period, he wrote 7 books on computers, all in Marathi. His another book, Blast Hole Drilling Technology, has been awarded a lifetime achievement by Indian Mining Journal and Central Mine Research Institute. It is being sold world over by International Society of Explosives Engineering. It's in US. May I now invite Mr. Gokhale to begin his session.
First of all, I must thank Mr. Devashish Basu and Ms. Suchita Dalal to organize this program, because not many people will organize such program. There is generally a considered animosity between chelation therapy and conventional medical doctor's stream. The importance today is that I want to explain you what is chelation therapy and all the related aspects. Coming to chelation therapy, but before chelation therapy, we'll go to a little background knowledge. You see, up to almost 1960, most of the people used to die by infectious diseases. Infectious diseases, as everybody knows, were caused by bacteria, viruses, and so on and so forth. Wonderful medicines invented by scientists and made by pharmaceutical companies, almost nullified the infectious diseases. Today you don't hear cholera, today you don't hear plague. Plague, in fact, is so devastating that in 13th century, it took a toll of about 100 million people. Almost half of Europe's population was wiped out with plague. Today you don't even hear that. Smallpox has vanished. In fact, they say that only germs of smallpox available are in US laboratory where they are preserved. So these infectious diseases have gone, and because of that, the life of a human being, average life, lifespan, has increased considerably. But now the next step is people die because of degenerative diseases. And degenerative diseases are much different than infectious diseases. Which are degenerative diseases? There are many. Heart disease is one, cardiomyopathy, Parkinson's disease, Alzheimer's disease, diabetes, diabetic gangrene particularly. These are caused because your body degenerates for one reason or the other. Now, what are the reasons? The reasons are found to be metal toxicity. You see, we live, say, 30, 40, 50 years, and continuously for all those 50 years we breathe. We take food, we take water, and so on and so forth. 200 years ago, the situation was different. What was the difference? The difference was that in those days, there was, the use of metals was to a much lesser extent because there was no industrialization. Once industrialization started, the use of metals suddenly increased. And naturally, the proportion in which they came in human body also increased. How it increased? See, first and foremost thing, we breathe air. So, in those days there were no batteries, no lead, no toxicity. But once the lead toxicity started basically in 1930s, of course it was started even in Roman days, because in Roman days lead was used for making pipes. But it was on a considerably smaller scale. It was known, lead was known to be a toxic metal for long. But particularly it started to a noticeable extent in 20s, when petrol was being purified with the help of lead. Some portion of lead was always remaining in petrol. That petrol used to go to engines. And once it was burnt in the engines, it went in the air. That was one. Secondly, so many different types of paints were made with lead. So, lead toxicity. Not only lead, every metal started. Nickel, then nickel was used for the alloy, added to the steel. So, nickel was used. Cadmium, we use nickel cadmium batteries for our cells. We throw them in waste paper basket. Waste paper basket is taken somewhere, Devnar or some such place, burned. The batteries explode. Whatever mercury, nickel, cadmium, all those metals mix with either air or go into the water if it is a rainy season. And that water naturally percolates in our lake. So, the amount of metals in our body has increased because of all these things. Now, these metals cause havoc in human body. How? See, metals, when we inhale through our breathing air, they get mixed up, these metallic particles. They are very small atomic size particles, some other molecules, and they go in our body because we breathe them, that those molecules or atoms are mixed with air, mixed with blood. And it circulates everywhere, right from our toe up to here. Now, when this happens, particularly metal atoms are very difficult to be removed from the body. You see, we have got two types of free radicals. One is organic and the other is metallic. Organic free radicals are easily wiped out by antioxidant or such thing, medicines, or even our natural system which improves our body conditions. However, the metallic components do not go out of body very easily. They go and stick to a cell, the membrane of the cell. If they are free radical, they can be in two forms. One is free radical, that means they have got deficiency of electrons. If such is the free radical, then it tries to steal electrons from the membrane. Now, human body cells are very capable. They don't allow free radical to adversely affect them under normal circumstances. But in the process, what happens? Just like, let's say, here you are, all of you are sitting. Some nasty element comes here and starts troubling. You will get bored, you will get affected, you will not be able to listen to me, I will not be able to deliver good lecture to you, basically because I will have my attention to that nasty element. Similarly, these cells, although they defend themselves capably, all the attention that they have got is only towards their defense from that nasty element. So, you know, they don't do their normal function in appropriate manner. If many cells of an organ have to do this, that means the efficiency of the organ goes down. This is all logical. Equally important is the fact that many metals they act as catalyst, or they adversely affect the metabolic processes. And because of that, several enzymes which are required to be secreted by a cell are reduced. And that is how the cells also don't start, don't do their function properly. Another thing which affects our body in older age is calcium. You see, from childhood we take milk and so on and so forth, which contains lot of calcium. It is used. Our bones, naturally, the volume of bone increases to probably 50 to 60 times from the day when baby is born. Later on, after say age of 20 or so, the calcium is not used to that extent. It is excreted from the body. But even when it is excreted, not everything or 100% it is not excreted. It remains accumulated in many places. And that is one of the reasons why heart disease is caused. Many of you may be knowing, might have heard that there is something like nanobacteria. Nanobacteria are probably the smallest organisms that are known to human race. They are so small that they can be detected only by scanning electron microscope. Normal microscope, dark field microscope, etc. cannot see them. They require magnification of about 1,00,000 to be seen. But they do exist. At least that is what has been said many times. And in fact, two Finnish researchers who put forth this theory of nanobacter were nominated for Nobel Prize in 1990s. Anyway, these nanobacters, small organisms, they circulate along with the blood. Their reproduction rate is very low. In fact, their reproduction cycle is of about 6 years. So, you know, they don't grow like, infectious disease organisms. They grow very slowly. And what they do? They go and get themselves attached to the arteries from inner side and start making a calcium membrane over there for themselves to leave their house, you know. Chelation therapy is one answer to them. So, with all these old age diseases or the processes which lead towards old age diseases, that is degenerative diseases, what I have said, there must be some method by which we are able to reduce the speed of degeneration of your body. Preferably, we should be able to get rid of them, but that is not possible. Nature has not made anybody immortal. So, it is virtually impossible, or rather, it is certainly impossible, as far as I see, that a person will become, immortal. But degenerative diseases can be reversed to some extent in many cases. It depends upon what type of degenerative disease you have got. Coming to chelation therapy. Chelation therapy is one of the methods which is used for reversing degenerative diseases. How it acts? First of all, what is chelation? Many of you may not have heard about chelation therapy. So, I will just explain you briefly. Chelation therapy is a very simple process. It's not a surgery or any such thing. In chelation therapy, we have a bottle of saline. The saline goes in your body. In that saline bottle, you have got about anywhere between, 7 to about 17 ingredients. Apart from the D5 or the dextrose solution or normal saline what you have got in bottle, there is potassium chloride, magnesium sulfate or magnesium chloride, sodium bicarbonate, various types of vitamins and minerals, and most important is a chelator. A chelator is a large organic molecule which has got capability of giving electron, giving electron at 6 places. That is EDTA molecule. There are, EDTA is not the only chelator, but there are many. Some of them have got 5 dentate, that means at 5 points, 5 atoms in the whole structure, they can give electron. Now, all these metals which I told you, arsenic, mercury, etc., etc., lead, cadmium, nickel, and aluminium, they have a deficiency of electron, as I said, and they try to steal electron from the membrane of the cell. So they want electron, and these molecules have excess of electron, so they can give electrons. So you know, they bind with each other perfectly, just like a spanner, hexagonal spanner binds around a nut bolt. So because of that, a chelate is formed, and that chelate, you see, body, human body knows that this chelator atom or molecule is a foreign molecule. So it naturally excretes it along with urine or stool, etc. So most of these molecules, 100% molecule, million out of million, they are excreted out of the body, and along with that, they take such metallic toxins, metallic free radicals. So what happens? The cells start growing in a much better way because their troublesome neighbor has been taken off. They can concentrate on their work. The efficiency of the organ is regained. That is one reason. The secretion of enzymes, etc., is improved because that element is not there. Equally important is the fact that with chelation therapy, particularly with EDTA chelation, EDTA is a chelator, and that molecule, the calcium which is excessively stored in our arteries, I said that nanobacter have got, or even plaque, what we say, blockages in heart diseases, etc., those are formed because of calcium which binds which keeps all those molecules of LDL cholesterol, oxidized LDL cholesterol together. It's the structure just like, you know, you have got wall. In the wall, you have got bricks, and in between the bricks, there is a binding cement. So, calcium does that work in that plaque, binding and keeping the molecules of cholesterol together. Now, if the calcium is taken off, the oxidized LDL comes in the blood, goes into the liver, and from there it is excreted. Slowly, it doesn't happen very quickly, but it happens. So, once the nanobacter shells are removed and this plaque is removed or destroyed or reduced, blood flow increases. So, one thing is almost 100% certain, that every individual to whom we give chelation therapy, blood flow from here to here, in every person, it is improved. And because of all this combined action, you know, many diseases are just reversed. Because many diseases are caused because of insufficient blood supply. Okay? Coronary artery disease is one, which is probably one of the most talked about diseases today. So that is reversed. Second is valvular heart disease, because valvular heart disease is also caused by calcium deposition in the valve, because of which the valve do not close properly and the flow goes backward rather than the right direction. And such things happen. The Parkinson, Alzheimer, diabetic gangrene, diabetic retinopathy, you must have seen those pictures where diabetic gangrene has been reversed because of chelation therapy, because basically gangrene starts when the cells over there do not get sufficient blood supply and the cells start without oxygen, they start dying, and that is a narcotic tissue. So that gangrene is reversed to a very good extent. You can see the photographs later on, or if you have seen already, that's good enough. So many diseases, which particularly the degenerative diseases, are reversed by the chelation process. Chelation is one of the process. Other is oxygenation, where we give hydrogen peroxide intravenously, and of course in very low proportion, because it can be very, it can have very devastating effects. But given in very low proportion, it can cure many ailments. Particularly, it is useful, as I said, in the process. Chelation breaks the calcium shell of the nanobacter, but it doesn't kill nanobacter. Nanobacters are killed by oxygenation therapy when we give hydrogen peroxide. So generally, for a very good treatment for coronary artery disease or many other diseases, infectious diseases also, swine flu and all that, oxygenation therapy is a wonderful therapy. There are many other things which I cannot keep on telling you, because these therapies have been proven so well that they have been found. Another is ozone therapy. Ozone, you might have heard about ozone therapy. So ozone therapy does virtually the same thing. So these are the basically three therapies that have been shown to have very good effect in reversing degenerative diseases. Now, your natural question will be whether these therapies are safe and to what extent they are effective. Well, safety wise, I can certainly say they are safe. They are safe in the sense, you know, anything in excess can prove poison. If someone goes for 1 hour in a room which has got 100% oxygen, most probably he will die. We say oxygen is required, but that is what will happen. If I drink tremendous amount of water, I will die. In fact, there was a case about 4 years ago in USA. There was a competition who will drink largest quantity of water in 2 minutes. One woman literally drank 14 liters of water in 2 minutes. She came second in the race. She stood for accepting the prize, collapsed there, and never saw the light of day again. She died there itself. So, you know, everything in excess can be bad. Naturally, in chelation also it is, I mean, chelation is no exception to that. In chelation, we give that chelator. It has to be given proportionally to the human characteristics. What? Like age, kidney function, height, weight, and sex. So all these 5 parameters are required to be looked into for calculating the right dosage for each and every person. Secondly, you know, it should not be given very fast, because the mechanism of chelation itself is such that if you give it very rapidly, the blood calcium is immediately absorbed by the chelator molecule and blood becomes deficient in calcium, and that can lead to dangerous situation. So, you know, in order to avoid such hypocalcemia situation, you must give chelation therapy very, very slowly. Similarly, oxygenation therapy. I cannot put 1%, the bottle should not contain 1% of hydrogen peroxide the maximum that is allowed is 0.15%. 0.15%, not 1.5%, 0.15%. So, you know, it has to be given in very low quantity in order to be effective and non-hazardous. So, all these therapies are required to be even in ozone. You have to give only certain proportion of ozone and certain quantity of ozone in the human body. So, all these things are to be done in appropriate protocols, and if the protocols are followed, there is hardly any danger. I can say there is no danger. To give you specific example of chelation, in the initial stages, that means when chelation therapy originally started in 1946 and later on up to 1956, it was in experimental stage. You see, doctors wanted to treat patients and get relief very quickly. So, they started giving huge quantity of the chelator into human bodies. For example, there were some doctors who had given 20 grams of chelator every day like that for 5 days. And people did die. Later on, slowly they started understanding what is right and what is wrong. And by about 1964, a general consensus was arrived that EDTA chelation therapy should not be given for more than twice a week. Every time the chelator weight should not be more than 3 grams. In fact, even that 3 grams should be reduced depending upon the age, weight of the patient, creatinine function and so on and so forth, 5 factors which I told. Now, these chelators are required to be given in small proportion. In 1969, the protocol was formulated, and that protocol said that twice in a week to be reduced according to the age and to be given very slowly. Very slowly means what? 16 milligrams or less only should be given in a minute. It should not generally exceed 16 milligrams per minute, that is the infusion rate. So, with all these things, from 1969 up to today, about 2 million people have taken chelation drips and there has not been a single death or any serious untoward incident. All the untoward incidents what have happened, whichever have happened, they have happened basically because of the negligence on the part of the treating doctor. For example, there were an accident. For example, there were 3 deaths in 2005. The facts involved were, the treatment was first of all was being given to very small children who should not have been given chelation treatment. In fact, the chelation treatment was basically given to the 2 children for autism. It was working quite well. What was happening? They were taking a chelator, calcium disodium EDTA. Now it contains already calcium. So you know it cannot induce hypocalcemia. Because calcium is already there, so it will not absorb calcium from the blood. So you know for 5-6 sitting, they took calcium disodium EDTA. And later on the next day, the nurse failed to notice that what she received actually was not calcium disodium EDTA, but disodium EDTA only. And you see, calcium disodium EDTA can be given very quickly. In fact, there have been instances that it has been pushed by injection within about 3 to 5 minutes slowly, but within about 3 to 5 minutes it has been put and it has worked quite well. I know one patient over here, I had requested him to come, he is 86 years old, one industrialist. He has taken several such injections of calcium disodium EDTA and is still intact. Anyway, on that day, the children were given drip, considering that it was calcium disodium EDTA, that means it was given very rapidly. But actually, what was there was disodium LTA, and that adversely affected and the children died. So it is an accident. You see, this is not a deficiency of the treatment. It is an accident, just like car accident. So, you know, even with all these things, I can say chelation therapy works very fine. It is safe. Going towards effectiveness. Chelation therapy is very effective. Almost, I mean, for heart disease, the success rate is almost 87 to 90%. That means 90% people who are advised to undergo bypass surgery may not have to do bypass surgery if they take chelation. Only a few may have to take. And that too, not essentially because bypass surgery is going to be the answer, but there is no other method, so try bypass surgery like that.